is Minergas. I co-chair the Women, Gender, and Sexuality Studies Council at Columbia University with Alondra Nelson. I'm delighted that we're doing this together. And I'm really delighted to welcome you all today to our first public event, which I think shows just how important it is that we talk to each other. We have speakers today from the medical faculty, from the arts and sciences, from the School of Public Health, from all parts of the university, and we are also here in my own school, which is the School of International and Public Affairs. So I think it's going to be a wonderful program. I think the idea of doing the keywords, which is an initiative, the Center for the Study of Social Difference, and Laura will briefly introduce the center in a second, is a great idea. And the fact that we're starting with vulnerability is also wonderful, because it's going to allow us to explore many different perspectives on the question of how you constitute the human subject and where and how gender intersects with other dimensions of the constitution, of our own experiences. So with that, thank you all for coming. Thank you to all the panelists and to Alondra for chairing this event, and to Laura for really putting it all together. I'm going to pass the mic.
Thank you all. Welcome. Real hype challenge. Very quickly, I just wanted to I want to thank Yasmin and Alondra Nelson as well, and all of our panelists in this keywords conversation. I'm Laura Chalkovsky. I'm Associate Director of the Center for the Study of Social Difference, and this is our first collaboration with the Women, Gender, Sexuality Studies Council. We're really excited to be doing this keyword session. Our interdisciplinary roundtable conversations is a series that is inspired by the innovative interdisciplinary scholarship of the center. The center is made up of 5 affiliates, and it's kind of an alphabet soup. It's the Center for the Study of Ethnicity and Race, the Institute for Research in African American Studies, the Institute for Research in Women, Gender, and Sexuality, the Barnard Center for Research on Women, and the Institute for Comparative Literature and Society. And we come together and try to draw people from very different disciplines to come to talk about a keyword. Today the keyword is vulnerabilities. And to basically explore the various ways we think about fundamental critical or theoretical ideas and to generate new vocabularies and new methodologies. So thank you so much for coming, everyone. I'm going to hand things over now to Professor Alondra Nelson.
Thanks, Laura. Okay, so good afternoon, everyone. As Yasmin Urgas mentioned, I'm a co-chair with her of the Women, Gender, and Sexuality Studies Council, and it's an initiative that we started last year with the support, we're grateful for the support of the Vice Provost for Academic Planning, Andrew Davidson, and Mara Jano, the Dean of the School of International and Public Affairs here, the very building that we're in, for supporting with resources and spirit the work that we've been doing. And the Council effectively tries to pull together leaders who are leading centers, initiative institutes on campus that variously deal with the issues of women, gender, and sexuality studies. And Yasmin and I spoke last year about this time and realized that there is a profound sort of richness in these areas, but that we don't have conversations nearly as often as we should. So we've been meeting in small groups over the course of the year, and as she said, this collaboration with the CSSD is a first public event. And the CSSD for a couple of years now has been doing these wonderful keywords events, and we thought it a great way to have a conversation with people who are working on women, gender, and sexuality studies, but use very different methodologies, have very different assumptions. To even endeavor something like consensus or agreement would be ridiculous and impossible. But there are certain kinds of words, interests, themes, urgencies that we gather around that we share, and vulnerability is actually one of these, but you'll see that we come to a term like vulnerability in very different ways. So my job today as moderator is just to, I'm going to introduce the panelists in turn, and then propose a few questions after all of the presentations and then open up for conversation. And I hope that the sort of range of perspectives and methodologies and assumptions allow all of us in the room to be able to sort of have a lever on the conversation, to be able to offer something to the conversation. So I look forward to fruitful and rich conversation and Q&A later in the afternoon. Okay, so let me introduce our first speaker. I'm pleased to introduce Professor Walter Bockting. He's a clinical psychologist and an internationally known sexuality researcher, and is co-director of the new initiative for LGBT health in the Division of Gender, Sexuality, and Health at the New York State Psychiatric Institute and the Columbia University Department of Psychiatry. He's also a professor of medical psychology and psychiatry and nursing here at Columbia. For 20 years, Dr. Bockting directed transgender health services at the Program in Human Sexuality at the University of Minnesota. He served there also on the graduate faculty of the Gender and Sexuality Studies program and was co-founder of the university's Leo Fung Center for Congenital Adrenal Hyperplasia and Disorders of Sex Development. His research interests include gender identity development, transgender health, sexuality and the internet, and HIV prevention. He's the author of many publications, including several edited books, among which are Transgender Health and HIV Prevention, and also Guidelines for Transgender Care. He is the editor-in-chief of the International Journal of Transgenderism. He's associate editor of Sexual and Relationship Therapy, and serves on the editorial boards of the Journal of Homosexuality, the Archives of Sexual Behavior, and the International Journal of Sexual Health. Join me in welcoming Walter Bockting.
Thank you for that introduction. Good afternoon, everyone. I will be addressing the concept of vulnerability this afternoon from the perspective of the LGBT Health Initiative at Columbia Medical Center. Let me tell you a little bit about the initiative. We are relatively new. The initiative was founded in the fall of 2012. It is located within the Department of Psychiatry and the New York State Psychiatric Institute, but in close collaboration with the Columbia School of Nursing. And we are in the same division, the Division of Gender, Sexuality, and Health, as the HIV Center, which has been there for 25 plus years. And investigators of the center, in time, really further expanded their inquiry into other areas of gender and sexuality beyond HIV. So the LGBT Health Initiative builds on the strength of the HIV Center and builds on the strength of the other expertise across CUMC in this area. And our mission is to promote LGBT health through research, clinical service, education training, and as well as public policy. So vulnerability and LGBT health. What do we usually typically think of? And I think we then think of the LGBT population being termed a vulnerable population. And then we think about the negative impact of social stigma and minority stress on the health of LGBT people. At the Health Initiative, we're certainly doing that now. This month, we launched a new longitudinal study of transgender identity development, where we're actually trying to identify periods of acute vulnerability over the lifespan of a transgender person, and then at the same time, identify factors of resilience that help transgender people make it through those vulnerable times. And those resiliency factors then will inform interventions and capacity building to facilitate that identity development and address the health disparities found among this part of the LGBT population. Another area where we are doing currently work is in the area of youth and families. And there we're looking at how families, whether these are families with LGBT parents or families that have LGBT children, how they are affected by stigma and what some of the unique needs of those families are. And then another area that we are just now beginning to develop is to improve access to care for LGBT elders. We're doing it in collaboration with SAGE, a community-based organization for LGBT aging. And we know from surveys that many LGBT people delay medical care, and that LGBT people, a third of them, plans not to disclose or does not feel comfortable disclosing their LGBT status if in long-term care, out of fear of discrimination and provider bias. So generally we think about vulnerability, I'd say, as a liability. But today I want to talk with you about vulnerability in a different way, not so much as a liability but as an asset. And I think that that really comes when I thought of my clinical work for all these years in Minnesota with the LGBT and particularly the transgender population. Then vulnerability was actually considered clinically a key asset, a very coveted intimacy skill. And the more skilled you were, the more you were able to show your vulnerability, the better oftentimes the adjustment in terms of relationships and psychosocial adjustment that as a clinical psychologist I was concerned about. I think when I think about vulnerability that way, I like to think of identity and intimacy as two very related concepts that are shaped that by trying to balance two basic human needs. And the one need is the need for individuality, for autonomy. And that includes asserting our LGBT identity. And it includes distinguishing our experience from others in the LGBT community. Hence the, you know, alphabet soup and the addition of Q and even I to LGBTQ and LGBTQI. So basically, every time a new identity emerges, it is a response of these identities not being validated, not being adequately addressed, and breaking out of that stigma and trying to, through a movement of resistance, trying to draw attention to the specific needs and the rights of different identities. And that is then about challenging norms, whether it's the bloodless heterosexual matrix, or whether it is challenging the idea that gender is a dichotomy and claiming a third or a space that is, goes beyond that dichotomy. On the other side, though, is the intimacy pole, and that really is more related to our basic needs for belonging and for interdependence as social beings. And I think that in that area, vulnerability particularly comes into play when it comes to felt stigma. And felt stigma is the anticipation of rejection, the expectations of ignorance and sometimes violence. So it's the internalization of the experiences of discrimination and violence that we witness in society associated with gender nonconformity. And I think in order to challenge those that felt stigma, in order to lessen it or overcome it, that's where vulnerability comes in. That's where we take calculated risks to actually test our assumptions and find that by exercising our agency from that point of vulnerability, we are able to go very far and find support in many different arenas, and also are able to contribute to society at large. So vulnerability, I think, includes such fears as the fear of abandonment, sometimes the fear of engulfment, but I think it also includes the fear of one's potential. And so oftentimes, stigma and discrimination and these negative anticipated reactions are familiar to LGBT people. Yet by being vulnerable, we can test them, and we can actually then break through that and lessen our fear of our potential and realize that if we work well with others, we can have it all. So this was actually commonly a very important conversation that I had with many of my clients. So let me tell you a story of one client in particular. This is a person who was raised as a boy, but who identify as a girl, a woman, I'll name her Alex for now. And she came to us in her late adolescence. And at that time, she had just acknowledged to herself that she was feeling like a woman, that her identity, gender identity is female. She had confided in her best friend, and with the help of us, she then came out to her family. At that point in her life, she talked about having been teased and ridiculed for her gender nonconformity, having gone through that period of time. Now, she asked for hormone therapy, she changed her gender role, she also had surgery, and we facilitated that. And then actually, as she started this young, she was one of those transgender women that actually could pass very well, and that could blend in easily with non-transgender women. So, and that way, she was able to escape the stigma, the enacted stigma that she was subject to earlier. And she moved to a different city. She got a job. She worked very hard and succeeded. And in that new city, in her workplace, and among the new friends that she made, nobody knew that she was transgender. So we didn't see her for a while, and then at some point she came back and she had a breakdown, and I said, what happened? Well, she just had been offered a great promotion on the job. See, again, there's that potential. I mean, you would think that you would be happy and move forward, but for her, this was a tipping point. You know, she was just, she had a complete breakdown because she thought, nobody knows that I'm transgender. If they knew this, I would not get this promotion. I don't really feel I deserve it. And at the same time, that's how these two things came together. She had been pushing herself to be out there, was dating, and had met a young man that she considered marriage material. And there also, she was very, very nervous how he would react, and she had no experience in that context to let people know that she was transgender. So what we did then is we encouraged her to attend a group for people who had gone through this process, and together they developed a consciousness, I would say, about what it is like to be not only a woman but a trans woman, and what the added value of being trans is. And as the group was affirming that, Alex eventually was able to come out at work and to come out in her relationships, and then actually developed into a very fierce advocate for LGBT rights, not just transgender rights, but LGBT rights in the Minneapolis St. Paul community. So just a story that I think illustrates that, yes, she first was part of a vulnerable population, but then I think she used her own vulnerability to reach her full potential, and from that place was able to contribute to society at large. So vulnerability in that second sense, it's not a weakness, but a source of power, compassion, courage, and change. It's a key ingredient in dealing particularly with that felt stigma and the barriers we have within to reach our full potential. Vulnerability is, in both ways, an integral part of the LGBT experience. And as a result of that, LGBT people often have a heightened awareness of gender, of sexual orientation, of living with a stigmatized identity, of and have an opportunity to develop the kind of skills to really, despite that, or in some ways you could say because of that, connect with other people and make that contribution to society, not only reach their own full potential, but also work with other stigmatized and disadvantaged group to address what we're all facing now, a growing inequality that we know we need to work on in order to promote health and well-being. So that's what I wanted to say. Thank you very much.
Thank you. That's a great and provocative start. We have lots to talk about. So I want to just take a moment to tell people that there's seats up front if you'd like to come up and take a seat. You don't have to hover in the back by the sunny window. I know it's warm in here. And I also wanted to say that in another hat, I am the director of the Institute for Research on Women and Gender, and in addition to the resources of the Provost's Office and the Dean of SIPA, we have to thank Vina Tran and Tess Drahman and also Bronwyn Miller, who's here at SIPA, for helping to organize today's events, today's conversation. Okay, so I'm delighted next to introduce my colleague, Kathy Ewing, who is, I'm grateful to her for serving on the Executive Committee of the Institute for Research on Women and Gender. In addition to that, she is Professor of Religion and Director of the Center for the Study of Religion and Sexuality here at Columbia. Her research has focused on debates among Muslims about the proper practice of Islam in the Muslim world, the place of Muslims within the German national imaginary, and sexualities, gender, and the body in South Asia. She's currently writing a book on the politics of sex change surgery within India's middle class. Recent articles include Naming Our Sexualities, Secular Constraints, Muslim Freedoms, as well as From German Bus Stop to Academy Award Nomination, The Honor Killing as Simulacrum. Her previous books include Arguing Sainthood, Modernity, Psychoanalysis, and Islam, Stolen Honor, Stigmatizing Muslim Men in Berlin, and the edited volumes Shariat and Ambiguity in South Asian Islam, and Being and Belonging, Muslim Communities in the U.S. since 9/11. Kathy Ewing, thank you.
Thank you, Alondra, and thank you to all the organizers for this wonderful conceptualization of a panel. I think it really gets us to think about issues in new ways, I would adjust my title even a bit since early this afternoon and call it Vulnerability, Perpetrators, Victims, and Rescuers. Okay, so this is a Facebook page of the person on the left, whose name is Ranjita, who is has been very active in changing the status of people who change their gender in India, in the Calcutta area. And she and the person beside her, Manavi, are people that I worked with in my research. And they are celebrating because in this photograph and on this whole page, because the law in India was recently changed by a Supreme Court decision that created a category, a legal category of third gender in India that has all kinds of implications, a couple of which I'll mention a little bit later. But I want you to just see them in this very public. You can see the bottom one there, actually, I think, on a TV show. And I won't read all of what Ranjita wrote, except that it's, because I don't have it right here in front of me, but they're basically celebrating an accomplishment of a social movement that they have been working on for a long time. And one of the key concepts that has come up in this movement is the idea of a vulnerable population. What I would like to do in these few minutes is to think about the idea of vulnerability. Here we have two people that at the moment are presenting themselves as agentive, as agents, as successful, as but the idea of vulnerability has been very important to their thought. But I think that the term vulnerability has had powerful implications for how we and they think about their community and how we think about ourselves in relationship to communities such as this. And I'd like to begin thinking about the concept with Judith Butler's description of vulnerability. She has said, vulnerability is not a subjective disposition, but a relation to a field of objects, forces, passions, that impinge upon us and affect us, a way of being related to what is not me and not fully masterable. Now, from this definition, of course, we're all vulnerable. None of us are masters of the universe. In some settings, we think of our own vulnerability in these ways. But in other settings, the idea of the vulnerability is also operates as a powerful signifier that can mobilize others for diverse goals and organize the world into perpetrators, victims, and rescuers. A world in which those who are vulnerable are often quite readily stigmatized, and those who are perpetrators are demonized, and those who are rescuers are become heroes. And that's an oversimplification, but what I'm trying to do is sort of unpack some of the baggage that sometimes goes along with the use of the concept. So this is in part an answer to the question of how the concept of vulnerability socially positions those who are labeled vulnerable. And I'd like to explore this use of the label vulnerable in, at first, a rather dizzying array of contexts before bringing it back to this specific population of the third gender. And thinking about how it has become a vulnerable population and what the effects of that have been. I want to begin with male or human vulnerability, but often depicted as male vulnerability, as a virtue. One in which men choose to be vulnerable. And I'll use a quote from Ernest Hemingway, who I think of a man, right, exactly, if there ever was one. And he says, the best people possess a feeling for beauty, the courage to take risks, the discipline to tell the truth, the capacity for sacrifice. Ironically, their virtues make them vulnerable. They are often wounded, sometimes destroyed. It actually kind of reminds me of a science fiction I indulged in reading last night, where the captain sacrificed himself for his crew, and we watch the way this plays out in the rest of the drama. Inspirational quotes, and you can find them, on vulnerability stress the vulnerability of being in love, open for wounding and for pleasure, a kind of vulnerability that is also seen as a choice. But perhaps some of the imagery of this kind of being open for wounding is also those who are vulnerable are, in some contexts, and I don't have time to go through the specifics, often feminized by being vulnerable. Now, to turn to male protectiveness and the idea of vulnerability in a slightly different setting, and thinking about nationalism for a minute, this idea of sacrifice, you know, this being vulnerable to being destroyed even, in the context of nationalism, rests, one could say, on a sense of vulnerability in that you know you can be destroyed by your enemies. In military, if you do a quick web search of vulnerability in the military, all of the vulnerability is usually in of weapon systems that are vulnerable to being destroyed, and so the reaction is to shore up and protect the weapons and to protect women and children who are vulnerable by sacrificing for them. So we have here the idea of the vulnerability as something that, in the context of the military, clearly involves for a kind of masculinized move of rescue of victims. The we can think about, I'm not going to take the time now, but we can think about environmental vulnerability in similar terms, the idea that that the Earth, Mother Earth, needs rescuing from our depredations. So even something as kind of leftist as the environmental movement can be seen as taking an analogous shape. Just moving more specifically into South Asia and some of this sort of more general ideas of vulnerability, and the idea that vulnerability is closely associated with rescuing women. Women are, of course, often depicted as vulnerable, especially third world women. And one of the goals of many NGOs is to protect their rights, to help them become less vulnerable. But in the context of especially post-colonial settings, we have the question of setting up the world into the vulnerable and the rescuers. Does this create a problematic relationship that I think was addressed by Lila Abouloughoud in a book where she asked, do Muslim women need saving by the intervention of, say, Bush's military forces in Afghanistan in the name of equal rights for women? Or another example, the association of women and nationalism in South Asia, in India, Pakistan, and Bangladesh. We've seen people like Veena Das and Gayatri Spivak think about women as the signifier of the nation to be preserved from violation and becoming an impetus for violent patriotism. Our women are vulnerable to attack from the enemy, or rape as a crime that foregrounds national vulnerability. In the moving more generally, sort of middle class vulnerability has been a powerful image in India recently. The concern that our women are vulnerable to rape, our children are vulnerable to abduction and sexual assault. And one of the goals has been for many politicians to create safe urban spaces for women and children. And then we have to think, well, what kinds of spaces might these be? What kinds of violence and what forms of governmentality are developed and strengthened to create and maintain safe spaces? So the idea of vulnerability, which begins with rescue, can then have somewhat problematic implications, including, for example, the death sentences of rapists as a new development in India, and sometimes a kind of a crowd mentality associated with protecting the rights of women. Okay, so I want to I want to turn to specifically the third gender issues. I don't know how much time we have. Okay, that should be actually enough. So I'm just sort of throwing out some of the conceptual background of the way the term vulnerability is used, the way it gets taken up in what can fairly easily become exertions of power that sometimes can take a problematic turn. So I mentioned that the third gender, often called hijras in India, has been the focus of NGOs, has been an increasingly visible movement to protect hijras and third gender more generally against stigmatization and discrimination. And with the Supreme Court ruling, the third gender has got rights, as I mentioned, in a specific, and become a specific social category, along with a number of other minorities. And this category is that of backward class, that then is becomes the focus of special rights because they have been the victims, have been vulnerable to discrimination. And so through the claim of vulnerability, they have been moving from a threatened population to a protected population. Raises some questions. Are there, for example, issues, problems with the kind of what some have labeled paternalism that is associated with becoming this protected category? Does it involve the reification of a population and the creation of boundaries that then perhaps reduce the agency of individuals to decide how they will be in the world? So I want to turn, just in the last moment or so, to a website that is describing a new docudrama about hijras. On the website, the term vulnerability is obviously central. We have, let's see it very well, you can see the various ways. So not just vulnerable to HIV, but to low self, many of the things you actually described. Low self-esteem, high substance abuse, reduces the capacity to negotiate condom use, violence, police harassment, lack of awareness of rights, poor employment opportunities, because, and thus the turn to sex work. And these have all been documented, and obviously there's been a lot of scientific study of some of these effects, the vulnerabilities, we could say, more generally. The effeminate, now, let me just get to the, I have to stop, but let me get to the last slide, which is the description of a documentary that's closely associated with this site. And it says that there are many efforts to curb the abuse of trafficking of girls, but now we have to focus on boys. The community lives on the margins of society and is vulnerable to exploitation. So the hijra community is vulnerable. But then, if we look at what the film is actually doing, it says that these boys are vulnerable within hijra communities. They're vulnerable to self-mutilation, in other words, choosing to have their genitalia removed. And so this docudrama is intended to rescue these boys from hijra communities. And I don't have any answers here, but I would suggest that this particular conjunction of multiple vulnerabilities as encompassed in this last few quotes illustrates some of the complexities of thinking about people as vulnerable and the need to rescue them.
Thank you, Kathy. We'll hear next from Marianne Hirsch, who is the William Peterfield Trent Professor of English and Comparative Literature at Columbia University, as well as professor in the Institute for Research on Women and Women, Gender, and Sexuality. She was the 2013 president of the Modern Language Association of America, and one of her presidential themes was vulnerability, so she comes to us as a seasoned expert on the topic. Most recently, she's the author of The Generation of Post-Memory, Visual Cultures After the Holocaust, as well as co-author with Leo Spitzer of Ghosts of Home, The Afterlife of Cernovitz and Jewish Memory. Her other publications include Family Frames, Photography, Narrative and Post-Memory, The Mother-Daughter Plot, and the co-edited volumes Rites of Return, Diaspora, Poetics and the Politics of Memory, The Familial Gaze, and Conflicts and Feminism. Please join me in welcoming Marianne Hirsch.
Thank you. It's really great to be here, and just a wonderful opportunity to think about whether a notion like vulnerability can offer a lens for the study of social difference. Is it a theory? Is it a paradigm? Is it a lens? What are we going to do with this word? I think that Walter and Kathy's presentations have already illustrated why feminists have had a love-hate relationship, more of a hate relationship, with the idea of vulnerability. The claiming a disproportionate vulnerability for women or for any socially disadvantaged group, as we've seen, stigmatizes that group. It brings with it a plea for protection that potentially signals weakness and the perpetuation of disempowerment. So it can sound a lot like victim feminism, and many feminists have really wanted to repudiate this kind of discursive register. And yet, even on our own campus, we've seen that the idea of vulnerability has gained or regained some currency among feminists. I think it's 3 years ago that the topic of the Barnard Center for Research on Women's Scholar and Feminist Conference was vulnerability, and the keynote address, I think, was Martha Feynman's, who spoke about, a legal scholar from Emory, who spoke about the vulnerability initiative at Emory Law School that's very active there. Last year at our own Earwigs conference, 25th anniversary conference, Thinking Feminism at the Limits, Judith Butler delivered the keynote address, and her topic was vulnerability and resistance. And Butler also co-organized this last fall a workshop on rethinking vulnerability and social change from a transnational perspective that was held at Columbia's Global Center in Istanbul. And it was part of the Center for the Study of Social Differences, Women Creating Change Global Initiative. And I was very fortunate to be able to participate in that workshop with a number of colleagues from around the world, because I was in the process of thinking about the topic for the MLA's upcoming conference, which was held last January in Chicago. And the topic I had named was not vulnerability, it was vulnerable times. And when the president names that topic, a topic like that, it's an invitation to members to propose panels and papers to be in conversation together around a specific topic. So it's kind of mini conference within the conference. Many, many people responded very favorably, and there were actually, of the 800 sessions at the conference, 200 were devoted somehow to vulnerable times. This could be good news or bad news. It could be that it's so general that anybody can fit, or it could be that people really wanted to sharpen this notion that it speaks to us, particularly at this moment in time. But just as many people contacted me to say, this is not a good idea. You really shouldn't be talking about vulnerability because it emphasizes the precarity of our profession. And this is not how we want to appear in the world. We want to appear strong and powerful. Well, my own interest in vulnerability derives from a longstanding feminist work on vulnerable lives, on lives that have been marginalized, that have been forgotten, or omitted from dominant histories and narratives. And it derives from an effort to find ways of inscribing these lives into the archives of history and memory without violating, without appropriating them. It's about thinking about how to do this kind of rethinking and remembering. But the interest in vulnerability, especially as president of a scholarly association such as the MLA, also emerged from a concern about precisely the vulnerable place of the humanities and the arts in our present moment. So I wondered whether an acknowledgement and a practice of vulnerability might be able to offer us a way to mobilize the work that we do in the arts and the humanities, textual, historical, theoretical, and activist work, for broader social and political platforms, and to be in conversation precisely with people such as the people on this platform who are in very, very different fields. So I was thinking that what would happen if we claim vulnerability as a space from which to begin rather than as a stigma to be overcome? And that's already been the theme here, and I hope we will develop it a little bit in our discussion. But I also wanted to do so, a place to begin, precisely by thinking about what contribution literature and art can make to our thinking about vulnerability. And I'll be showing you some images. I will discuss some of them, but maybe not all of them. It's meant to be a kind of counterpoint here. So in her book on time, Eva Hoffman writes, "It's tempting to say that finitude is the intrinsic cost of life and that vulnerability is a necessary correlative of vitality." I think when we think of vulnerability that way, we think that of the ways in which, as an embodied species, we share a common vulnerability that emerges for precisely from the condition of living in bodies, of living in time. It emerges from our relationships and attachments that make us susceptible to loss. But this appeal to a shared vulnerability as a fundamental species condition also carries the risk, a number of risks, and certainly the risk of ignoring radical differences of power and privilege. So it seems to me that the challenge of invoking vulnerability is to stress that vulnerability is also socially, politically, and economically created, and that it is differentially imposed. It's to stress the historical and geographic specificity of vulnerabilities at the same time as its broad reach beyond the human to other species and to other animate and inanimate forms. In fact, if we see vulnerability as a space of connection among and beyond humans, it can generate, I would think, an ethics and a politics of openness, of attunement, and also of resistance. To be sure, there's a complicated and troubling history to the term, and Kathy has done a wonderful job summarizing some of this, saving me quite a bit of my talk here, because as Kathy mentioned, vulnerability is widely used in the language of security and defense. It served as an alibi for arms buildup, for violent conflicts during various wars, whether the Cold War, the War on Terror, and various disputes around the globe. While we speak about vulnerability to attack, to terrorism, to atomic threat, to natural disaster, we take off our shoes when we go into an airport, we play along with this discourse of vulnerability that can be mobilized for various political purposes that we may be very much in conflict with. And certainly, Kathy already outlined the gendered nature of this invocation of the language of vulnerability and the ways in which an aspiration to invulnerability or to inviolability can cause the building of walls, starting of wars, and various kinds of nefarious political acts. But also, we've also seen how in a number of fields, vulnerability can be invoked for very different kinds of purposes. And I'm hoping that we can discuss a little bit more the conjunction or the opposition between vulnerability and resilience that Walter brought up, because, and maybe Richard will speak about as well, because that's another kind of opposition that worries me a little bit, because it could sound as though, you know, nothing against resilience. Of course, we all want to develop as much of it as we possibly can, but it sounds a little bit more like accommodation to a situation than real resistance and change. And I would like to see how we can mobilize the idea of vulnerability for change rather than for the development, just for the development of resilience. So, I think that feminists have actually claimed vulnerability as a space of resistance. I think Jo Spence shows us that in her own humorous way. For Martha Fineman and the Emory project, the idea of a shared vulnerability offers a way to counteract US liberal and neoliberal ideas of autonomy, self-reliance, and equality. They aim to create a space for a political discourse of interdependence and care in which active state intervention in human communities would not be seen as exceptional, and in which institutions could reduce susceptibilities to injury for individuals and communities. And in the Istanbul workshop, Judith Butler and Zeynep Gambetti, who co-organized it, enjoined the participants to highlight various socially imposed gendered vulnerabilities and to mobilize these as resources for developing what they called new modes of collective agency and alliance that would be characterized by interdependency and public action and with strategies of resistance. So how can we bring the humanities and the arts into these interdisciplinary conversations about vulnerability and to think precisely about resistance from this perspective? So we might think about how vulnerability is fostered and taught in our aesthetic encounters, and that's really what I want to spend the last few minutes talking about. What can vulnerability do? In our acts of reading, looking, and listening, we necessarily allow ourselves to be vulnerable. I don't think we can be good readers if we're not vulnerable to the text that we read. Reading, looking, listening, these acts join us to practice openness, interconnection, and imagination, to acknowledge our own implication in the text that we study. If they teach us vulnerable reading practices, however, do these aesthetic encounters also enable us to respond to fellow humans and other life forms? Can they teach us resistance as well as vulnerability? So in my own work, I thought about this specifically in my work on the ethics and aesthetics in the aftermath of violent pasts. And I thought precisely about the ways in which we might make ourselves vulnerable to what Susan Sontag has called the pain of others, whether our ancestors or more distant subjects in the past or in the present. Our contact with past or distant atrocities is clearly mediated by imaginative investment, by projection, by conventions, by what Robert J. Lifton has called formulation. But current pedagogies, especially in schools around the country, encourage students to respond to the pain of others through empathy and identification. But in my own work, I've really thought about something else, about what it would mean to have a more distancing awareness that cultivates a solidarity that resists an easy empathy and identification. And I think aesthetic responses can provide a platform in which to practice vulnerability as a form of resistance, as a form of attunement and responsibility, but also of resistance. Responsibility not as blameworthiness, perpetrators or rescuers, but as in the sense that the legal scholar Martha Minow has so helpfully suggested, as the ability to respond. So I just want to look at two brief examples of works that have helped me think about this. One is a visual artwork by the American artist Laurie Novak, an 1987 image called Past Lives, that I think enables such an exercise in responsiveness that is made possible by incongruities that leave space open for distance between past and present, between self and other, that open without blurring boundaries, without homogenizing suffering. So let me just explain this image. It's not so clear. It's based on an archival photograph, and it's a photograph of the children from the French village of Vizieux, Jewish children who were in a boarding school to be rescued, but who were denounced and deported and then killed in Auschwitz. So this image circulated widely in 1987 because along with the, at the time of the trial of Klaus Barbie, who was responsible for murdering these children, or for deporting and murdering these children. So Novak found it, a cropped version of it, on the cover of the New York Times Magazine, and she superimposed it on two other images. One is, you can see here, the face of Ethel Rosenberg, another victim or another subject killed by the state, and then an image of herself and as a young child and her mother. So looking at this projection, well, first of all, it's very blurred, and you really don't know exactly what you're seeing, and I think that's important. So when the artist who grew up in the shadow of traumatic histories in the 1950s that she didn't herself experience literally grafts these onto her skin, Is she identifying? Is she empathizing with the victims? Is she appropriating their story? Or rather, can we say that she's allowing herself to be marked by their stories, taking responsibility for their legacies and for her own implication in the 1987 present in which Barbie was being brought to trial? In reframing these archival images, Novak is making them more blurred and more difficult to see. And it seems to me that with this blurring, she's resisting an easy appropriation of the visual field. They gesture toward what might be outside the frame of the visible, and thus toward aspects of the past that the images themselves render invisible. And so she mobilizes these images from the past and brings them into the present, and allows them to act in the present, that thus provoking, I think, new pedagogies of looking. So I have 3 minutes. I'm gonna. What happened here? This is terrible. Well, maybe we won't read Adam Jackson's poem, or I'll try to read it to you. I wanted to end with a poem because I'm a literature professor, after all. And it's a poem by Adam Zagajewski, the Polish poet, and it's called Try to Praise the Mutilated World. And it was a poem that circulated widely just after the 9/11 attacks. In fact, the New Yorker printed it in that 9/11 issue that they published in the next week. But Zagajewski actually wrote it in response to a trip that he took with his father through Ukrainian villages in Poland whose inhabitants were forced out during population removals following the Second World War. So, I mean, it's interesting how these different histories touch each other. So I'm gonna read you the poem because I think there's something very inspiring about and thought-provoking about what he says about praising the mutilated world. I don't know if you can follow along. Remember June's long days and wild strawberries, drops of wine, the dew, the nettles that methodically overgrow the abandoned homesteads of exiles? You must praise the mutilated world. You watch the stylish yachts and ships. One of them had a long trip ahead of it, while salty oblivion awaited others. You've seen the refugees heading nowhere. You've heard the executioners sing joyfully. You should praise the mutilated world. Remember the moments when we were together in a white room and the curtain fluttered. Return in thought to the concert where music flared. You gathered acorns in the park in autumn and leaves eddied over the earth's scars. Praise the mutilated world and the gray feather a thrush lost and the gentle light that strays and vanishes and returns. So what does it mean to praise the mutilated world? I wonder whether to praise is somehow to be responsive to and responsible for contradictions without trying to resolve them. Perhaps it's to embrace the potentialities of a vulnerability that's also resilient and hopeful, the gentle light that strays and vanishes and returns. I think that Zagajewski's aesthetic of vulnerability confronts us with a fragile beauty of hope and resistance despite multiple and repeated assaults. So when we encounter these images, these words, these poems, we hear the devastating stories that they tell, the hopeful moments that they come back to reclaim. And I think that Zagajewski's invitation to praise is an invitation to practice vulnerability and resistance through reading, looking, and listening. And I hope that we can keep talking about that.
Thank you very much, Mariana. We'll hear next from Professor Richard Parker, who's Professor of Sociomedical Sciences and Anthropology and Director of the Center for the Study of Culture, Politics, and Health, as well as a member of the Committee on Global Thought here at Columbia University. He's also Director of the Brazilian Interdisciplinary AIDS Association, one of the leading non-governmental AIDS organizations in Brazil, as well as the founder and current co-chair of the Sexuality Policy Watch, a global coalition of researchers, policymakers, and activists. In addition, he's editor in chief for the journal Global Public Health, which is published by Routledge and housed here at Columbia, yes? Yeah. Please welcome Richard Parker.
First of all, I want to thank the organizers for putting this together and making it possible for us to be on this roundtable. It's actually been fascinating, both the email exchanges and hearing other people talk. Each one of us was asked to, in the sort of best tradition of keywords, come at this from our own kind of specific position, both disciplinarily, but also in terms of the research that we do. And it's interesting, even though we have different entry points, we actually are coming up with some very similar kinds of problems that we're struggling with in thinking about this fascinating term. For me, it's my thinking about vulnerability is very localized historically, and it really comes out of my work, not so much my work as an anthropologist, but my work as a researcher on the AIDS epidemic for 3 decades now. I was a doctoral student in San Francisco in 1981 when the AIDS epidemic sort of descended on us, and for the past 3 decades in work both in the United States but particularly in Brazil, I've focused much of my attention on the epidemic. And my encounter with vulnerability has been very much through the framing that took place in responding to AIDS. 30 years into the epidemic, it's always difficult in a room like this that has a wide variation of ages. Some of the older people in the room probably lived those early years of the epidemic, but many of the younger people actually didn't. And it's hard to remember a time very early on when AIDS was met largely by silence and certainly by extreme discrimination and stigma, with essentially no meaningful response from the medical establishment in the face of the epidemic, and a profoundly stigmatizing response in relation to the difference of the populations that were affected by the epidemic, and that were seen in some ways as being responsible for the epidemic and for its devastating effects in their lives. The result was that the epidemic of HIV infection and the illnesses associated with AIDS was almost everywhere associated with an epidemic of blame and accusation. In the face of silence and inaction on the part of officials and the official structures of public policy and public health systems, many of those involved in the first wave of responding to the HIV epidemic were from affected communities themselves or were their allies, especially gay men, but also injecting drug users, sex workers, transgender people, and some progressive allies in medicine and public health, especially coming from a tradition of social medicine with its Marxist roots, and progressive public health workers who emphasized not just the biological body, but also the social body. And precisely because many of the dominant kind of biomedical categories that were used to think about the epidemic were so deeply enmeshed with notions of blame and accusation, by the closing years of the first decade of the epidemic in 1988, 89, 90, many of us were struggling to push back against that kind of blame and accusation. And one of the earliest ways that I think we did that was to try to think about what Jonathan Mann originally called the third epidemic, to think not just about the epidemics of HIV infection or the epidemic of AIDS as people became ill and suffered in profound ways from the disease, but to think about the third epidemic of the social responses to the first two, the way in which stigma and discrimination were deployed in a way blaming the victims of HIV infection and AIDS for their own circumstances. It's interesting, as I was hearing the other panelists talk, thinking about some of these historical connections, I hadn't thought this through before, but there actually are some interesting intersections with the closing years of the Cold War, the fall of the Berlin Wall was exactly at this point in time, and a sort of rethinking. There was, I think in the late 80s and the early 90s, there was kind of a wide scale attempt to rethink the notion of security in a post-Cold War world. That may actually, it may not be an accident that some of these things were being thought about it at about the same time. But vulnerability, in my own experience of AIDS research, began to be spoken about at exactly this point in time in research networks that brought together social researchers, progressive public health people, and AIDS activists. To try to think of a way of reframing the kind of blaming notion of kind of behavioral risk, which individualized and behaviorized and blamed people for their own circumstances of risk, and to try to reframe that or decenter it by thinking about a notion of social vulnerability as opposed to behavioral risk. And vulnerability was then first articulated in epidemiological terms as a way of trying to do a social epidemiology rather than a behavioral epidemiology, and as a way of trying to think about a series of factors that positioned people and communities and populations in relation to social circumstances which created their risk. Not behavioral individualized risk, but social vulnerability. And that in turn, I think, led fairly rapidly for many of us who were fundamentally concerned with issues of inequality. It led in the direction of trying to think about all of these issues as issues of structural violence. Whether or not the structures in question were the structures of economic exclusion and poverty, whether they were the structures of racism and ethnic discrimination, the structures of gender power inequalities, of sexual stigma and oppression, and also, although in some ways more complicated, age-based inequalities and differentials. In short, it was a way of trying, we deployed the terminology of vulnerability at that point in time as a way of trying to kind of refocus attention on the social drivers of the epidemic and on the way in which socially accepted and legitimized inequalities drove the epidemic and impeded efforts to try to combat it. So in that sense, and just to sort of try to wrap up and make it possible to open up for discussion, which is in some ways the most interesting part of all this, it seems to me that vulnerability, at least as we deployed it in the late 1980s and the early 1990s, and I think that deployment may have changed over time, but it was a way of trying to sort of dislocate supposed responsibility for the epidemic from people's own stigmatized practices to the social circumstances, to the stigma discrimination themselves, that oppressed the people who were affected by the epidemic. And hence to understand the need for a fundamentally political response to the epidemic, not a technical or technocratic kind of response, but one that would be based in struggles for empowerment, for collective mobilization, for political action in the face of socially determined forms of vulnerability. And in some ways, I think that's where it comes back to things that all of the other speakers have emphasized with this relationship between vulnerability, power, and empowerment, and struggles for empowerment in the face of such widespread forms of social oppression.
Okay, so So I'm going to endeavor just to make five or six just quick kind of statements slash queries that I think sort of tie together some of the things that we've discussed today. And the speakers can have a short response, and then we can open up. Or we, if there's no one's motivated to have a response, we can just go right ahead to conversation. We'll see how it goes. So the first thing I wanted to begin with, I wanted to come back to the issue of compound stigmatization, as vulnerability as compounded stigmatization. And it's something that certainly Mariana and in some regard Walter identified, but we didn't quite dismantle it. So we sort of say we have this, you know, this feminist conundrum of compounded vulnerability or compounded stigmatization when we talk about vulnerability, but it wasn't clear to me that we know quite what to do with that conundrum. Secondly, I thought we might take up the issue or the question of, does vulnerability have a gender? Is vulnerability gender, that Kathy begins to tease out for us? Is vulnerability sexed? And then tying together Kathy and Walter a little bit, does a third gender or a fifth sex, thinking about Anne Fausto Sterling, transform this, right? Does this offer us another way of thinking about vulnerability? Does it give us the change that Mariana was suggesting that we need? And you know, thinking as well as in part of Walter's talk about the emergence of new identities to which you referred, is that, are those new identities new forms of vulnerability, or new forms of vulnerability in a pejorative sense, vulnerability in a positive sense, for example. Thirdly, I wanted to talk a little bit about the where Walter took us with thinking about vulnerability as a resource and an asset. And Mariana took some of this language up as well. They used other sort of synonyms for vulnerability: intimacy, courage, compassion, change, attunement. But I wanted to sort of just push back, lest we get too happy about vulnerability, to a phrase that Walter used, which was calculated risk, right? And so that even if there's the promise of intimacy or courage or compassion, there's this calculated risk, you can be harmed, right? That the sort of engagement with vulnerability suggests that, and I wanted just to put that on the table. I thought we could potentially talk about the scale of vulnerability. On what scale does it operate? We have a couple of indicators here. We have, in Walter, the interpersonal and the intimate, so in a micro scale. We also might think in Mariana's piece in particular about the scale of the imagination or vulnerability on an aesthetic scale. And then we could think also about vulnerability as having a kind of macro scale. So vulnerability vis-a-vis the state, vis-a-vis social movements as a social movement tactic or a social movement frame, and as a protected class. Mariana also offered for us maybe a kind of linguistic way of thinking about vulnerability, almost as a lingua franca, as a starting place for a conversation, as a language with which to begin. We might take that up. And then just two last points. You know, also provoked by Mariana a bit, but the very sort of gathering at this table today, why vulnerability now? Are these especially vulnerable times? Why do we move from a sort of critique of victim feminism, as Mariana suggested, to a moment in which some of our sort of leading thinkers are coming back to vulnerability as the sort of topic around which we need to gather to think anew? And then lastly, this is a somewhat literary response, I think, but that motivated out of Richard's presentation and this idea of social vulnerability, to think about vulnerability's modifiers. So social vulnerability, racial vulnerability, sexual vulnerability, and implied sort of by each of these, biological vulnerability, and to maybe sort of think kind of through and across those. So I would leave those as a few ways that I saw that the presentations were sort of talking to each other. And if you want to make, any of you want to make a response, and then we can go to the audience.
It's such great questions, but maybe we should go to the audience and keep them in mind, because I think it would be wonderful to come back to some of them.
Excellent. So we have about 40 minutes. Plenty of time. Please, yes.
In response to Mariana's comment and your later question about vulnerability being a starting point for a greater conversation, I think it's a very beautiful idea and it has a lot of potential, and I also think that one of the dangers in it is to fall very quickly into the confessional mode where one party becomes the listener and the other party becomes the speaker. I'm speaking from personal experience. It's very easy once you become open to expressing vulnerability to not know how to stop, and for the listening part of me. And it's also the same with text, to, on one hand, and I'm speaking from my personal experience again, to on one hand want to listen, and on the other hand then not know how to separate myself from becoming the protagonist, getting angry at the author, not knowing what to do in that situation. So those are my personal problems.
Could you hear that in the back? Yeah. Okay.
And I think that what you're expressing is precisely what I think is coming out of this conversation, which is the kinds of messy entanglements that I think we've all talked about, and intimacies and ways that can't be controlled. And the ways to control it, of course, is to build barriers and build walls and aspire to invulnerability and to inviolability and to separation and to autonomy and to all the things that we're actually taught in the kind of American ethos of self-reliance. So, and which we all know is not true. So how do we then use this knowledge, which is, and I love the fact that you say, I'm talking from personal experience, because I think that is the way to talk about this. But we can also talk about it from, on this completely different scales. So if we talk about the planet and the environment, which has already come up, and some of the images I showed really attempt to represent that, that's a very different way to talk, but I think probably with some of the same issues and questions. So how do we mobilize, for example, and this is quite abstract for us, climate change and how it's going to affect the species is very abstract, because it's not going to be probably in our lifetime or even in the lifetime of the next couple of generations. So how do we, what do we do with this knowledge so that we can actually begin to do something about it? Do we use fear? Do we use some other forms of, some related forms of vulnerability to make us act? I mean, clearly it's not happening from purely cognitive understanding, because we all have that, except, you know, some of our presidents. What do we do? So maybe delving into some of these messy entanglements that you're expressing might offer a way.
Yeah, I just want to say that intimacy is by definition messy. Mm-hmm. And I think that I would suggest love rather than fear in terms of the starting place. And I think it is, you know, working it out together. And if you also think about the balance that I showed, so we're not going to drown in intimacy, because then the identity part will come back up. But I think as a starting place, I really think about that a lot of our movements cannot really solve the larger problems that we're facing on their own. So we need to work with each other to address it on all levels, including our planet.
Great, thank you so much. And I'm thinking about a talk that Kathy was at recently, when Afsane Najmabadi came to talk about her new book called Professing Selves, about transsexuals in Iran, and the way that they have mobilized and become a category, like, you know, backward classes that even get special privileges, but as vulnerable populations, and therefore they got state help, they get health care, they get all kinds of things, and police protection from the police, and all of that. And the question for the gay community there, even though we can't use that word, but whatever, is, you know, they're trying to say, well, we can't argue for rights, because if we argue for rights, then we're using, we will be hard with the brush of, you know, the West and Western rights talk. So should we also make ourselves a vulnerable, you know, classify ourselves within this governmental category of vulnerable population in order to get the same kinds of protections, the same kinds of help? And so there's vulnerability and the opposite with rights in that context. And I thought that's really interesting here, because that word wasn't really confused at all, and what happens when we say vulnerable, what happens to that other language, which has been one of the great, I mean, I have problems with it, but the great political languages of our times, you know, sort of to claim something, which is, again, autonomy, you know, all those other kinds of modes that uses rights of. So I don't know if that's interesting to anyone, or we could sort of put that out on the table, but it seemed to me the opposite keyword.
Well, just a quick comment on that. It certainly, in relation to public health, that set of connections was very much part of the development of thinking about vulnerability, and it really, I think, it went sort of in two directions. If people were coming at it more from a Marxist perspective, they went in the direction of structural violence, but the other kind of response was health and human rights, and in fact, even the timing when vulnerability started to be articulated in relation to the HIV epidemic was at exactly the same time, was right before the Vienna Conference on Health and Human Rights, the UN Conference in 1993, and the journal Health and Human Rights was created in 1994 as a consequence of the same people who were talking vulnerability trying to find a rights-based way of moving forward and intervening in relation to vulnerability, with all the limitations that has, obviously, but the connections are definitely there, at least in that particular space of thinking vulnerability.
Yeah, in terms of the people that, specific people I'm talking about here, the idea of vulnerability and the idea of rights are intimately intertwined, to the extent that once a group gains a kind of labeled identity with certain rights vis-a-vis the government, the next step, and actually I talked about this a couple of weeks ago in the talk, was to say we have these rights because we are of a particular identity, a particular category. And those people over there who haven't actually had their genitalia excised don't have the rights, these rights. They are fake. They are impinging on our economic and social turf, and the police should be sort of acting against them. So I just keep perhaps overemphasizing the diverse ways that these specific terms that mobilize people can also, in the next breath, be used in a different way.
Any other questions? Yes, ma'am.
It seems to me, thinking also about what Kathy just said, that the other way of thinking of vulnerability is as non-impermeability, in a sense, that you are vulnerable to the extent to which you don't cast off. You're not headlong, so to speak, right? And you don't have a protective casing. So that's one. Your protective casing, but as Walter said, the protective casing is also essentially a source of weakness to the extent to which it doesn't allow the asset, the vulnerability, to function as an asset. So you don't have...
Or you need both.
Right, and yeah. So...
But both has its strength, and it's the balancing act. That's the messy part.
The balancing act is what enables you to simultaneously constitute yourself as a subject, and also establish you in the in an interactive process that doesn't leave you unchanged.
And I'm suggesting that we've done a better job on the identities. Mm. I was thinking with you, we're just going to put more in the soup, in the gumbo, until everybody is in it. Whereas I think there's more to explore on the coming, starting at a place of vulnerability. Going to that direction.
Right. So the last thing, just to close on this, is it seems to me that it's a way of thinking that enables us to think about the constitution or the development of subjectivity and experience as a process, because it means that you can participate in an experience and be changed by it, and it enables us to see how from these processes of both distinction, establishment of distinction, but also of opening up and questioning and refashioning, we then end up with something that is quite different. So what you referred to as the alphabet soup is not really additive, it's actually transformative. Mm-hmm. And that's what I think. And so finally, to come back to one of the questions that Alondra raised, why vulnerability now? I think it's because we're thinking about the transformative, the transformation of our frames mm-hmm. of reference. Mm-hmm. And that, not that I have an answer to that, but that seems to me to be both the anxiety and the wealth of the moment.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yes, please. Thank you so much for the talk and thank you for the great question. It makes me think a lot. It would be great if someone can really break down of how can we transform what vulnerability means into more change or into like resistance or empowerment. Or you were asking the question of like we start thinking vulnerability as asset, but it's also scary that to jump into the conversation because vulnerability is more than just asset, and we have to take a step to reach to the place to think vulnerability as asset, or how can we use vulnerability as change, not just the resistance, but social change. So it would be great if you can break down a bit more the process of how can we transform the vulnerability in such a context or discourse, and especially you were talking about, Patrick was talking about, Richard was talking about how vulnerability was used to bring up the social vulnerability of the role of social injustice in HIV epidemic. So if you can talk a bit more how people use the concept of vulnerability to transform the conversation from biological responsibility, individual responsibility, to social responsibility. Mm-hmm. So that process, that would be great. Thank you.
Well, just specifically on that, I think that transforming that into change or it's using an analysis of vulnerability as kind of a point of departure for sort of Paulo Freirean style consciousness raising. I mean, it's critically analyzing the social circumstances that position you in this situation of vulnerability. That's the point of departure for a kind of process of critically decoding your own existence in ways that make it possible to take action to change the circumstances that are making you vulnerable. And at least at a level of community organizing around some of these issues like HIV, that's a very powerful step forward. And it really, I think, helps many communities to overcome. So there's something about vulnerability that if others are classifying you as vulnerable, is much more problematic than if you yourself are able to develop an analysis of your own condition of vulnerability and use that as a point of departure for fighting back. At that level, sort of classic AIDS organizing, ACT UP, the AIDS Coalition to Unleash Power, itself, the name was a theory for action in relation to AIDS-related vulnerability.
But then, if you classify yourself as vulnerable as a group, how do you then avoid appearing as a victim or classifying yourself as a victim? And I think that's the conundrum that I think Alondra asked us to think more about. What do we do about that? So it seems to me it's not the groups that are classified as vulnerable or that appear the most vulnerable that need to be doing that. I think the ways that we need to change thinking is to see that as the norm. I mean, that is the condition. We are vulnerable, and we know we're vulnerable, except, and we don't, but how do you then not turn that to, you know, the language of security and protection and paternalism and all of that, but just accept that as the norm. What if that's the place from which to start, and that's everybody, but that vulnerability is also differentially imposed because the disasters that we're part of are, you know, as Ariel Azoulay, who's a wonderful political theorist and visual theorist of visual cultures, talks about regime-made disaster. Mm-hmm. So it's not that, you know, it's just the same for all. Of course it's the same for all of us to some degree, but we know that susceptibilities to various kinds of diseases is also socially manufactured by poverty, by nutrition, by various kinds of things. So it's how to sort out that if that's the norm, and then you also look at the differential creation of vulnerabilities by social and political regimes, I think that's where we need to start. And that's not at all a question of victimization or victimhood. It's really a question of a social life that operates, and political life that operates with these major inequalities.
Right, and sitting around the table with people that maybe we haven't talked to very much in the past, with new partners and building bridges. I think the transgender is a good example because it's a relatively small community. So it's not about doing it together, even though that was a necessary step, like for the client that I shared. But subsequently, what she had to do is build these bridges in her daily life, interwoven with every aspect of society. And that takes some creativity, but it's very exciting.
I guess I would also add that as several people have been thinking about vulnerability as a kind of opening up, as a sort of different basis for moving forward, I think one of the problems that we keep falling into is that close linkage of vulnerability, victimhood, and identity labels. That if we thought about vulnerability as a taking off point in ways that you did that tried to evade the identity label, way of falling into thinking about the social world, things might go in a different direction.
But I love the question that you asked us that we also already brought up, which is, does vulnerability have a gender?
Yeah.
And I love that question in relation to the third gender. Mm-hmm. And it strikes me that the idea of the third gender, it strikes me that if we just did away with the two genders and thought of the third gender, really, then I think the whole we would be starting in a very different place. If we thought of three genders or multiple genders rather than two, because I think the problem with the way we're talking about vulnerability is the oppositional ways of thinking, victim, perpetrator, all of those things that we brought up. So if we thought of the third, then maybe something else would begin to happen. Mm-hmm. So vulnerability has the third gender, I would say.
Yes, Amaya.
Thank you all so much. Something that I hear throughout all of the presentations and some of the questions is the implicit relationship between vulnerability and visibility. Mm-hmm. I wonder about the relationship between vulnerability and invisibility. So how can we use the vulnerability frame to empower and form resistance without further shining a light on the most marginalized?
I think that another assumption that we tend to make is that which is invisible is problematic, that secrets are bad, that which we can't see must necessarily fester, and therefore that the solution is to shine a light. And that's another assumption that I think we could challenge.
Jessie?
I'm not sure if this is going to make sense, but Professor Hirsch was talking about vulnerability as like differently imposed, and I guess I wonder, or maybe it bothers me a little bit, like if then we still have this construction where like the closest to not vulnerable is like the white male Western subject, whatever. And like what work that does when like the thing that the whole concept is like constructed against is still some person who, although like you're saying everyone is vulnerable, who is like less vulnerable maybe. And then I guess thinking about Professor Abulukul's comment then, like, is that where like human rights come? Like, is that what allows us to like, and I think then contains that problem, like we have vulnerability as like the absence of these, or the challenging of these like defined rights that still are these rights that are constructed for a certain subject. And is there a way, if that makes sense, then is there a way to think vulnerability that doesn't do that?
I think more of vulnerability as a process, and it's ebbs and flows, and not as a state where we need to bank people on that particular state.
Mm-hmm. But I think that it's a great question that you're asking, and I think that if we started from an acknowledgement of vulnerability, I think we wouldn't be having to ask the question in exactly the way you are, and having these hierarchies of who's the most vulnerable and who's the least vulnerable. But I think the language of rights and of social rights is a language, or at least a set of practices that tries to protect certain populations from the extreme vulnerability. And that is really how it's laid out. So if we wanted to think about it differently, and we see the problem with the, you know, with rights as a way of responding, then I think we would have to kind of turn the question around and try to think of it from a different perspective.
Other questions?
I mean, think of Republican discourse that's, you know, is everything is totally individualistic, and you don't need, you know, the state to intervene with medical care and whatever, you just pay for your own. I mean, that's right. That's the other way of thinking, but that's, I don't think we want to go there. So.
Yes. So also I wanted to thank you all. This was very interesting. I was wondering about this idea of using vulnerability as this currency towards getting rights, and I thought it could be dangerous. So I'm thinking about the feminist community, for example, and I feel like in many ways, as we gain like consciousness and awareness to the problems, we are also becoming a lot more fragile, because we can now recognize all these things that are happening to us, and we take them, and we have to like construct ourselves as vulnerable to them in order to say something about them, and I find that sometimes weakening instead of empowering. And I think you touched that when we were like talking about the correlation between victimization and vulnerability, but I was thinking, could we find a different way of like phrasing it that isn't so embedded in the me and my feelings and my emotions and my sadness, and more about like the social aspects of it?
So, I mean, there again, we're kind of in an either or language, and I mean, it's very hard to talk about these things because we, you know, we're sort of trained to think in certain ways. So I'm wondering whether empowerment is the best way to think about it. And it's not empowering, it, you know, whether that is the measure that we want. And I think if that's the measure, then we want that, certain things follow from that. But if we don't want to think about empowerment as, because, and is there a way to think about empowerment without thinking of disempowerment? So I'm just answering you with one question.
I would also like to think of maybe vulnerability as a language of though, as almost an advantage by groups who can speak about their vulnerabilities as a group, because that kind of leads out people who cannot come together as a group and yet are still vulnerable, such as women who are dispersed amongst the world with men and not able to come together as a group. And then with language of vulnerability, and then bringing in asking for rights, like, for example, special group rights for different religious communities, that puts a blanket of vulnerability over the group, but then doesn't really go deep enough to understand the vulnerability of the people within that group, such as the women who are
even more vulnerable, but because of that type of protection. So in a way, it's almost privileging to be able to talk about vulnerability from a group's perspective because of the ability to actually come together as a group.
Kathy, you're our resident religion expert, and we haven't talked so much about religion. Anything you might say about religion and vulnerability? And groupness, or inability to group.
Right. Well, what you say brings to mind, one of the arguments about women in a religious minority group, such as Muslims, ones that I think about the most, who then when there are, that it's posed as this tension between group rights and religious rights versus the right of the woman who somehow doesn't seem to have rights in terms of the way that the religion was organized, so that women are somehow disadvantaged and such. It's one of those very difficult to resolve tensions that in the ways that we think about the individual relative to the Constitution and such. It has produced incredibly complex and problematic responses. So I can't give an answer, but I think what we see in India is, again, a somewhat different constitutional solution that in the case of third gender seems to be an option that creates all kinds of openings and yet problems. In the case of women, because groups do have, religious groups do have somewhat more ability to sort of personal rights law that is administered within religious communities, it does leave women saying, what do I have to leave the religion altogether in order to have any rights? It's one of those unresolved, the whole structure creates this problem.
So it takes two more questions. There's one back here.
Yeah, this is really fascinating. Thank you very much. I'm a psychologist, so I wanted to throw in sort of a different perspective and vulnerability. And one of the things that I think is important to tease out is the idea of vulnerability as a relational concept. And if you think of vulnerability as a self-disclosure, in and of itself, that's actually where the scale and the resource and the empowerment comes in. And I think Dr. Bockting, you were talking about this as well, it's a form of increasing intimacy. And Brene Brown, who I think also is a psychologist, talks about this when she teaches workshops on how to be vulnerable at an interpersonal level. I think where it can become problematic is at the community and political and group level is where there's a power differential among groups. So who you're disclosing to will have an effect. Interpersonally, if you have equivalent power positions, vulnerability is actually a resource for human connection. When there's a power differential, where the politics, the government, vulnerable groups at the, let's say, health level come in, that's where it can actually create damage. And I think it's very interesting that you brought up the idea of your client using this intersection of vulnerability at the individual level, but bringing it into the work situation and having some trepidation, I assume, at disclosing herself, right? And in this instance, she was well received, but she could have also been damaged. And so
yes, but it's kind of the model of changing the world with one person at a time.
Yeah.
So then it is indeed finding the people where you feel safe enough. Because I think you made a good point that when there's a power differential, it makes it a lot harder.
But would you agree that power differential, you can't have interpersonal power differentials? Or, that was what you were sort of suggesting in your comment.
Well, I guess what I was saying is you can have interpersonal power differentials, but I would say that where vulnerability works as a resource and as a form of real human connection and openness is where the power differential is low or none.
It's manageable or non-threatening.
Yes.
Or not threatening enough.
Yes, exactly.
One last question or comment? Ayana?
Do you guess?
Yes, is that?
guess, is there an example that you can bring about where a vulnerable identity that's used as a means of activism and power has not become also a tool of, let's say, oppression in itself, or hasn't been completely turned around and not just used as a leverage, but, you know, the harm?
That's a great question.
I think it's an inherent dilemma,
yeah,
in terms of how we've talked about it today.
A constant struggle.
Yeah, I mean, you can think of it in ways that populations that are powerful use vulnerability as their resource. You know, for example, you know, we need to build security walls because
right.
we want to be inviolable. I mean, so that's a negative example. Mm-hmm. But I think that it's probably inevitable. And so, but I think, again, if that's where we start by saying that is inevitable, I think that could lead to a mobilization of activism. Just even that, to see that conjunction, would enable people to come together, right? And is, I mean, isn't that how resistance movements actually get started and how ACT UP work, right?
Exactly.
So.
Yeah, I just can't say this. Yeah, I think one of the critiques of Habermas's envisioning of a public sphere where people could come together for conversation, and somehow this power differences would we could sort of keep them out of the conversation. I think is impossible. And
yeah.
I would agree that it's how people come together and split apart that is part of the basic process of politics.
But I think if we come together in resistance movements thinking only about empowerment but not thinking about, and I think that was what was so brilliant about Judith Butler's talk last year on vulnerability, is that if you think of, and she was talking about the new, you know, some of the new bodies in the street and in the square coming together in these new protest movements. If you, how can you think about those social formations without thinking about the very vulnerabilities of those bodies?
Mm-hmm.
And if you bring in the vulnerability of those bodies, I think you think about them in very, you know, you think about the movements in very different ways and how they operate.
So last word, I mean, I just wanted to venture that interdisciplinary and truly cross-disciplinary conversations are one of the most vulnerable things that we do as scholars. And so I want to deeply thank and tip my hat to Walter Bockting, Kathy Ewing, Marianne Hirsch, and Richard Parker for venturing that for us today. Thank you.
And thank you, Alondra, for your excellent
presentation. Yes.